To continue the conversation surrounding KUKA and how they are mobilizing production through the use of AMRs in manufacturing, I would like to, at this point, introduce Denise Stafford to deliver our first application and action presentation. In her role as Business Development Manager for KUKA Robotics, Denise works with local sales and account management to provide customers in North America with innovative automation solutions using AMRs and other advanced technologies. She offers valuable insight for both KUKA and their customers on a wide range of topics such as Industry 4.0, mobility, and human-robot collaboration. Please welcome Denise Stafford.
Thank you, Jared. And thank you for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk a little bit about what AMRs are now doing today in manufacturing. So before I go to the examples, let me show on the next slide where KUKA is coming from and why I'm so confident that we know what we're doing. Because we are within automation since the beginning of automation. So founded in 1898, we first manufactured some things, and then when robotics started to be a thing, we were part of that. We were a pioneer. We had the first mechanical arm. We had the first PC-based controller. And then it wasn't surprising that when the world went through towards, you know, maybe we think about mobile navigation and now having something driving around, we invested about 15 years ago. We started with research. We bought a company that had these omnidirectional drive system. So, and then, you know, we tested, we researched. And then about 10 years ago, we really started to take this to the next level. So we produced prototypes. We tested with pilot customers. Then we had generation one, generation two, generation three. So, and everything, you know, we have now is really based on these 15 years of experience and 10 years of that really with customers in manufacturing. So on the next slide, you will see I talked a little bit with customers this year, actually very intensively. I did a survey with our customers. And one of the questions I asked them is, why are you using AMRs? What are your top reasons? So top reason number one is it's more flexible and also, it's not very much interfering with existing processes. Of course, it depends on the AMR, you know, application, but that was the answer they gave me. It's more flexible compared to fixed automation and also sometimes compared to AGVs, which were like confined to an installation on the floor. It could only go a certain way. So that was reason number one. It's way more flexible. And that was over half of the people I asked gave me that reason. The next reason is that you start out and you as a company and you want to manufacture things and you bring automation in. So you might bring a machine in. So this machine comes in, it starts doing its job, but now this machine demands a certain amount of parts that are coming in, you know, raw material, and then after it finished, somebody has to take it away. So now you have another bottleneck again, right? So adding AMRs to other robotic cells or machines was kind of the next logical step. And then the last is they say, you know what, Denise? They are now proven technology. You know, there are now so many different, so there are more and more companies who are doing AMRs, who testing out, you know, more customers understand what it can and cannot do. So they consider as this technology is proven at least enough for right now so that we can do and do real-world projects. So let's start and let me show you some examples about point number one. What do I mean with more flexible? So let's look at the next page. So one of the things that are very, very helpful in a manufacturing environment are conveyors, right? So they bring things from A to B to C, but then at some point, you might not want to install another 100 feet of conveyor. You need more flexibility. So what people do is they use an AMR, they put a conveyor on top. I call it a mobile conveyor. I don't know if that's a real name, but that's how I call them. So you now have stationary conveyors and mobile conveyors working together. It can be an easy conveyor, as you see on the top left, or a little more, you know, expanded conveyor with different levels, as you see on the middle of the page on the top. So it makes a conveyor system way more flexible. On the top right, you see an AMR that can transport a box or a pet, you know. So often they bring now parts to an assembly line from one assembly line to another, or from an assembly line to the warehouse. So it's flexible, but it's not really interfering in this case with the assembly line itself. So that's what I mean. It's a little bit less interferent because your manufacturing is the same. You just add at the end or in the, you know, in between. You connect more than you interfere with the process. Down to the left, you see that while this is an AMR, it's called AGV. So this is a Daimler plant in Turkey, and they automotive is doing mobile robots, AGVs, for decades. So it's nothing new in automotive, but the flexibility that comes with an AMR, it's just giving them more applications they can do with it now. So in this case, the AMR is combining different welding cells. So instead of having conveyors, they combine them. And actually they did that already with AGVs, but now with the technology coming out, way more flexible, they can now go with less AMRs than they had AGVs, but have a higher output. And then on the bottom right, you see a really big one. So if you're now thinking about flexibility, if you have really big parts you want to drive around, your options are a little bit limited. So often you have these huge crane systems on the top, which of course you have to install them, it costs a lot of money, and then they're there. So not very flexible. So these are just a few applications to show you, you know, why customers regarding flexibility put AMRs in place. So now on the next slide, you will see the second point. What does it mean, productivity increase of automation equipment? On the top left, you see a palletizing cell. So often, another not too much interfering robotic process customers put in the manufacturing environment is adding a palletizing robot. So at the end of the line, you know, instead of having people packing or, you know, pallets being stocked, so they put a robotic cell in to palletize. But now again, you have to feed the robot and you have to take the pallets away so that the robot can really work at its best. So palletizing is one of the key applications where customers now add AMRs to. And then on the top right, you see a lab. So in a lab, these are all manual machines. So the mobile robot is going around and feeding all these machines without a human operator. And in this case, and the other examples I have down there, often it's not so much about, and actually nearly any time, it's about really replacing people. I want to get rid of people. It's of, can I add a third shift? Can I run through the night, right? So you can still do it manually, but maybe you don't find people for the third shift, or you only, you know, you don't want to do overnight. So on the top right, you see a lab, all these machines connected by the AMR. Down left, a lot of applications is loading and unloading of machines. On the down left, this is a tool changing of a machine. In the middle, these rolls you see is packaging material for teabag machine. So it's taking it and putting it in the machine. And down to the right, it's 3D printer. 3D printer unloading. Specifically with 3D printers, they print a long time. It's often under the day when people are around, it's not a big issue. You know, one machine is ready, go out, 5 minutes, take it out, done. But at night, you don't want to have a person coming in at 2 a.m., at 3:30, just to unload this 3D printer. So that's applications for productivity increase. Okay, if we now move on to the next slide. There are other reasons, and they are typically connected to worker ergonomics and safety, which is also connected to people don't want to work in manufacturing. If it's dangerous, if it's boring, if it hurts me. On the top left, it's rack to person. So instead of a person going through racks and picking out, the racks are brought to the person and the person just picks this one thing out of the rack, The next req comes up until the order is fulfilled. Then in the middle, you see automotive manufacturing again. And the top right, it's now above the environment. So you cannot see it in this picture because we are not allowed to take pictures there. But the semiconductor industry, cleaner environments, not a good environment for people to work in. So they were one of the first coming out to us and say, we need robots in semiconducting, in the clean room, because you can only work there for a certain amount of time. And every time somebody comes in, a particle might come in, even though they have their processes. So there is a clean room version of this specific robot for that reason. And then down left is another big application, because when I talked this slide before about the cranes, it's not only the flexibility, but also the safety. You now have an overhanging crane and a really big part, that's a safety issue, right? To do this manually, and then it might, you know, start to swing. Or as on the bottom right, you know, loading tires into a container, you know, it's not a very healthy environment. So these were these applications. So I talked about. So point number three was proven technology. What do I mean with that? So let's have a look at the next slide. So first of all, companies that are developing and manufacturing AMRs starting to really build a portfolio. Now that we know what we need size-wise, payload-wise, environment-wise. So as you know, for example, we have 250 kilograms to 100 tons. We have a cleaner version, and you know, we have IP54, everything else is IP54 because we are in a manufacturing environment. So there are just a lot of portfolios built so that the customer has enough to choose for their applications. And then on the next slides, the other thing is then what feature set does the AMR need? And again, because of 15 years of trying out being in manufacturing with the AMRs, there are just certain things you need, we now know, like a safety LiDAR system, but they are 2D. So we added 3D cameras. Then why the LiDAR system works well with, you know, it's called slam navigation, looking around and depending on what it sees. But if it doesn't see anything, you have to be more precise. So we added cameras. There's a camera on the top you can position underneath the rack, a camera to down if you want to high position or need navigation. So there are a lot of features now that just makes it easier to implement them. And coming to my last slide, the other big part I talked about, that AMRs are connector, they're connecting things, but that also means they have to connect to these other systems. So the upper system understanding what has to be done, then to different machines. So they have to be really connected. So it's a lot of software. Good for you that over the last years, also the software, how software is created, changed. So instead of learning how to code, nowadays, you know, you just have to learn how to use the software of the specific provider. So you configure more than you code, right? So on the top right, you see the graphs. The graph is the network where you want to have the robots to go. And now they're even pre-configured elements. So you put in, this is a charger. So it's already knowing, okay, this is a charger with the charger node. You know, this is a rack. You know, this is where it has to go. So it's already easier to just set up the graph. Then in the middle, you see a workflow. So instead of coding everything, you say, I want to go from A to B, and then I have to wait for 3 seconds. So it's like building blocks you put together to put together your workflow. And then again, the connector, it's you have to talk to peripherals. So the software is also prepared to talk to other elements, to sensors, to PLCs, to a gate, to, you know, whatever is in the factory, using protocols that are now industrial standard. And then at the end, you might want to see what's really going on. So you have a dashboard that shows you battery status or whatever is important for you for the process. So that concludes, you know, the real life the AMRs are living now these days in manufacturing. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much, Denise. I really appreciate you taking the time to speak with us today. And thank you again to KUKA for sponsoring today's event.
making automation easier.